Thanks for joining me again here. I really like those kids up on the stage there, worshiping and moving, dancing back and forth and singing along with Michael W. Smith there. Just brings a smile to me when I see that and get to sing along with that. Hopefully you received an email and maybe a hard copy in the snail mail already, that we are going to be able to begin meeting together here at our church facility starting June 21st. Same bat time, same bat station, but really looking forward to being able to do that. Please read through that newsletter so you don't get surprised when you show up here. We are going to be outside in compliance with the county orders. Just excited to be able to be together again starting that day. We will keep you up to date as things progress, as things open up, as to how that affects us and what we're able to do, but just very excited to be able to do that. In the meantime, what we are going to be doing this morning is honoring our high school graduates. And I have some words for them, but they're really for all of us here. And thinking about graduation, I really like what President George W. Bush said several years ago to some graduates. He said, to those of you who received honors and awards and distinctions, I say, well done. And to the C students, I say to you, you too may one day be president of the United States. So graduation is a big mile marker in your life. You have had to make some unique sacrifices this year because of these COVID conditions, but it is still definitely a mile marker for you. And graduation has a way of making you think about life. Hopefully, it's making you think more about life. It might make you think, why did I have to go to school? Is this accomplishment going to help me enjoy life more? And isn't graduating supposed to help provide me with some meaning and with some success, at least some direction in life, right? Because when you finish school, what are people going to ask you? What are you going to do now? Well, there's a fairly short book in the Old Testament that's trying to answer this. What's it all about? What's it for? What's life for? And I think students and everyone ought to read this. And let me tell you how this book on life begins. You go to chapter 1, verse 1, and here's what you will find. Meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher. Utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. And you may have uttered those same words in some of the classes that you had to take when you were going through school. But if this were being written today, I think Solomon, the author of these words, might say something along the lines of, whatever, whatever. You know, everything's just pretty much whatever. Considered to be the wisest man of his day, this is how Solomon begins his manifesto. Now, this book, Ecclesiastes, it will eventually have an answer to the meaning of life. But the truth of the matter is, most of the people who are finishing school this year, most of the people in the workforce, most of the people who are retired, in fact, I think most all people, period, don't really believe what Solomon is going to say. People will try to find life and they will try to find meaning in everything that Solomon is going to say has no meaning. And I guarantee you that you graduates and the rest of us will have the opportunity this week and every week of our lives from here on out to prove if we believe what Solomon says. Solomon tried all sorts of things to find success and meaning. He kind of, what he does is he puts his own life in the lab and he does an experiment, and he records the events of his life, and then he interprets the results for us. And I picture what Solomon has to say about life in this way. I imagine that Solomon has like an Instagram or a Snapchat account. And over the years, he has posted pictures of his life and this experiment to find meaning. Now, as he writes his book, he's a little older and he's reflecting on that life. And he's looking at his life pictures and he realizes that he needs to post some comments about these pictures. And he clicks open the first picture and it's entitled Pleasure. Can meaning be found in pleasure? And there's a picture of Solomon when he clicks open this picture here. And he is in his luxury box at the Giants game. Leather couches, TVs all over the place, waiters, hot wings and nachos and margaritas surrounded by gorgeous women. That's the first picture he sees in his social media history. And Solomon is compelled to make a post, a comment to go with this picture now as he reminisces. And we're going to find that first comment here in chapter 2 of Ecclesiastes. I'm going to read the first three verses here. He makes this post. I thought in my heart, come now, I'll test you with pleasure to find out what's good. But that also proved to be meaningless. Laughter, I said, is foolish. And what does pleasure accomplish? I tried cheering myself with wine and embracing folly, my mind still guiding me with wisdom. I wanted to see what was worthwhile for men to do under heaven during the few days of their lives. And so Solomon, he sets out to be a pleasure seeker, to do what felt good, to have fun. And where pleasure was concerned, he didn't hold back anything. And then he looks at another picture. And in this shot, he is sitting in front of his mammoth summer estate. And let's put it in the hills of Napa. He's got a couple of supercars in the driveway. Jay-Z is waxing the hood of one of his cars. Elon Musk is pouring him lemonade. The Dallas Cowboy cheerleaders are picking grapes for him. And he is holding up in this picture a deed to Napa itself. He now owns Napa. And Solomon looks at this picture and he has to post another comment. So I'm going to pick up in verse 4 of chapter 2 and then jump down to verse 8. I undertook great projects. I built houses for myself and planted vineyards. And then down to verse 8. I amassed silver and gold for myself and the treasure of kings and provinces. I acquired men and women singers and a harem as well. The delights of the heart of man. I became greater by far than anyone in Jerusalem before me. In all of this, my wisdom stayed with me. I denied myself nothing my eyes desired. I refused my heart no pleasure. My heart took delight in all my work, and this was the reward for all my labor. Yet when I surveyed all that my hands had done and what I had toiled to achieve, everything was meaningless. A chasing after the wind. Nothing was gained under the sun. Solomon looks at this very picture and he says, whatever. If whoever dies with the most toys wins movement or club, wanted a poster child, it would be Solomon. But he ended up saying, whatever. And it wasn't that the girls were ugly or the wine had gone bad or the supercars were lemons. Those were all very fine. But he came to realize that these brought him no lasting joy. And you and I live in a culture that's pretty driven, I think, by greed and materialism and pleasure. And my hunch is that you graduates, and again, all of us, will get little support to take Solomon's words seriously. And it sounds like Solomon says, you know, my closets are full. My bank account is full. My garage is full. My retirement is full, but my heart is empty. Solomon clicks on another picture, and maybe we could call this picture, can meaning be found through knowledge? And in this picture, like some of you have just done, he's got his cap and gown on, giving his valedictorian speech. Solomon is an exceptional student. His own teachers, his own professors are in awe of his knowledge. And in the picture, the professors are kneeling and some are standing and applauding him as he receives his diploma. And Solomon feels compelled to post another comment under this picture. So we'll start in verse 13 of chapter 2. I saw that wisdom is better than folly, just as light is better than darkness. The wise man has eyes in his head, while the fool walks in the darkness. But I came to realize that the same fate overtakes them both. And then I thought in my heart, the fate of the fool will overtake me also. What then do I gain by being wise? And I said in my heart, this too is meaningless. For the wise man, like the fool, will not be long remembered. In days to come, both will be forgotten. And like the fool, the wise man too must die. Tony Campolo, Baptist minister, sociologist, what he said a long time ago is true. You are going to die. Male and female, red, yellow, black and white, rich, poor, skinny, fat, popular or unpopular. Nobody is exempt. You're going to die, and they're going to, what Tony said, they're going to throw you into a hole in the ground and throw dirt in your face and go back to the church and eat potato salad. What's it all for? The guy who gets an A in chemistry gets buried in the same dirt that the guy who got a D gets buried in. The girl who goes to San Diego State still winds up buried next to the guy who goes to DVC, who winds up buried next to the girl who goes to Oklahoma Christian. Solomon realizes that all his amassed wisdom and knowledge can't protect him from the same fate that awaits a dropout. And in light of the certainty of death, getting an A in calculus or English or econ just didn't cut it in terms of giving life meaning. But you parents are getting nervous now, you graduates. Won't a better education provide me a better job? Yeah, it very well may do that. And maybe Solomon thought similarly. And so he clicks on another picture that we will call work. Can meaning be found through work? And that picture is a photo of Solomon's first business card. And on his business card, it just says, the king. And think about this. Is there a better job than Solomon's? Some, maybe all of you, are going to get to have what our culture says is, man, you got a good job. It might not start out that way. You may have to do some stinky jobs first. But if and when you get that great job, it's still probably not going to be quite like Solomon's, right? He's a king. And he had success as a king. He was internationally known. He brought wealth to Israel, to himself, and he expanded the kingdom's borders. And Solomon looks at that picture and he posts these comments. I'm going to start in verse 18. I hated all the things I had toiled for under the sun, because I must leave them to one who comes after me. And who knows whether he will be a wise man or a fool? Yet he'll have control over all the work into which I've poured my effort and skill under the sun. This too is meaningless. So my heart began to despair over all my toilsome labor under the sun. For a man may do his work with wisdom, knowledge, and skill, and then he must leave all he owns to someone who hasn't worked for it. This too is meaningless and a great misfortune. Solomon had a great job. But again, he says, after I die, what will it mean? What is the next guy going to make of it? And if Solomon would have been around to see what his sons did make of it, he would get confirmation on his despair. Well, here's what I think Solomon is ultimately getting at through the entirety of what he writes in Ecclesiastes. Pleasure and knowledge and work, they may not be bad in and of themselves, and they really may improve the quality of life. But ultimately, they can't make life worth living. The same is true for you graduates and all of you who are listening right now. I really do hope you get some thrills, get to experience some fun things, have some pleasure. Go enjoy a baseball game or a concert, and I hope we get to do that before too long. I hope they start opening things up. Be happy and thankful that you're having some good hot wings. Enjoy your job, the rewards of your education, the benefit of having your mind equipped. Those really can be wonderful things. But all of that really can't make life worth living. In a way, Solomon sounds a little bit like a character named Curly in a movie called City Slickers. I don't know if you graduates have ever seen that. It came out about 11 years before you were even born. But hopefully your parents will remember that, or maybe they'll sit you on the couch and make you watch it with them. It's funny. But one of the characters in the movie there is this older, sort of grizzly ranch hand named Curly. And he does these cattle drives, and he works a ranch. That's his life. And what happens is these sort of city guys come out there, you know, for a couple of weeks to have this outdoor experience, like it's supposed to, you know, change their life. And he's talking to Billy Crystal, who's kind of lost in his purpose and his marriage and life. And Curly looks at him and he says, "You guys spend 50 weeks a year getting your rope all knotted up and expect to get it untangled in 2 weeks out here." And then he looks at Billy Crystal and he says, "You know what the meaning of life is?" He says, "One thing." And of course, Billy Crystal asks him, "What's the one thing?" Well, if Solomon were talking to Billy Crystal, he would say what Solomon says at the end of this book. Now, all of it has been heard. Here is the conclusion of the matter. Fear God, keep His commandments. That's the whole duty of mankind. For God will bring every deed into judgment, including every hidden thing, whether it's good or evil. He finally understood that one thing had to infiltrate and dominate every area of his life to be sold out to God, encompass the entire meaning of life. And Solomon, really what he ends up doing, he kind of concludes that life doesn't really work well when God is a side dish. And maybe that is more the real problem with us. We don't want to get rid of God, right? But we are sometimes afraid to turn everything that we have and everything that we are over to Him. We think that might leave us feeling unsatisfied. So it's not that we want to scrape God off, you know, off the plate. Just be a side dish alongside some helpings of stuff and pleasure. For all of us, and you graduates especially, I want to ask you to consider deciding something this week. I want you to seriously consider doing something that so many other students in the Bay Area will not do. I want to ask you to take your education, the opportunity that it gives you, the money that it's going to bring you, the pleasure that it can afford you, and I want you to just surrender that to God. Let Jesus have it and do things with it that you never dreamed of. Because in your latter years, you're going to want to have a bunch of these life pictures of people that you have served in the name of Jesus. Pictures of people you have shared the story of Jesus with. Pictures of people whose lives have changed eternally because your job and money and time was under the lordship of Jesus. One way or another, you are building a photo album of your life. So be wise and build one that's full of Jesus, surrendered to Him. So I want to ask everybody watching now to enjoy some of these videos here of our graduates. They've worked hard at putting these together, and I hope you enjoy seeing these and all the pictures. God bless you guys.
I was a little girl alone in my little world who dreamed of a little home for me. I played pretend between the trees and fed my house guests barking leaves and laughed in my pretty bed of green. I had a dream I could fly from the highest swing. I had a dream. Long walks in the dark through woods grown behind the park. I asked God who I'm supposed to be. The star smiled down at me, God answered in silent reverie. I said a prayer and fell asleep. I had a dream that I could fly. it full and I lived it well. As many tales I live to tell. I'm ready now. I'm ready now.
Thank you. Get all things.